Hello there. Thank you for being here. Today's topic is demography and human capital. Now, most people don't know what these terms mean, so maybe it's best to start by defining what they are. Don't you agree? Okay, demography, a field I discovered in graduate school, is the scientific study of human populations, their size, their composition, and their distribution, and the process by which these populations change. Now, what makes a population change? Only three factors: the interplay of fertility, deaths, and migration, in the context of social, economic, political, biological factors. Now, human capital is the sum total of a population's health, knowledge, education, training, skills, in terms of their value or cost to the country. It's an asset, it's a resource, and having it means a lot to a corporation or a country. Now, for instance, business firms or even universities, they like to recruit the best people they have. Very well trained, high education, very well connected, because they know that a business or a university is only as good as the kind of people they have. And that's human capital. So a country is the same way. If a country has a lot of well-educated people, well-trained people, well-skilled people, then the country is much more ready to withstand the challenges of development and even things like a pandemic. And that's what we'll do today. Today, we are going to look at the educational achievements of many countries of the world, and we will make comparisons and we'll draw implications about the patterns that we see. Now, before getting to it, let us have a little background context and talk about the world population. All right, are you ready? I'll be flashing a lot of charts, so just be patient with me. Now, the first thing, the population of the world today, if we can look from the world clock, is 7,884,026,230. Very hard to say anything because the numbers constantly change. There are now 150 people added to the population every minute, 220,000 a day and 80 million a year. That's about the size of the population of Iran, added to the population every year. Now, you see we're going fast. And just to show you how fast, I'll show you another slide about the size of the world population over the past 1,200 years. You know, it took thousands and thousands of years for us to develop 1 billion people. And if you look at the 1 billion people, we moved to 1800s. That's about the first billion. After so many thousands of years, then it took us another 100 years or so for the second billion. And then it took us about 32 years for the third billion. And it took us 14, 15, and now it's just within 15 to 20 years that we get 1 billion after the other. So you see, we're moving very fast. It's like the population of the world is on an express train, traveling uncontrolled to Busan, whatever the destination is, moving and moving upwards. And the United Nations tell us, where are we going from here? Now, the United Nations has four estimates. And what they have is the high estimate. And they think that if we were on the fertility level as we were, let's say, 10 years ago, and that's the highest estimate, by the 2100, which is 80 years from now, we will be like 20-something 5 billion, 26, 24, 26 billion there. Very, very high. Now, the UN has an estimate of the low estimate. Let's forget about that because we're almost reaching there. But the medium estimate here, that's the population we'll probably have in 2100. And that totals about 9.4 billion people from our 7.7 billion now. So we are moving towards the 9.7 billion. Okay, and we're moving very fast. Now, but something else is happening in the population. If we want to go another chart, let me show you the world population growth. I said we're moving up. You see where, if you look at this graph, look at the violet lines. It is moving very, very well up there. But then notice, it is going down. But look at the green shade that's going up. That's where we are now. That's our railroad express to Busan. We're going up, 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 up. But we're also going down. We're going up in numbers, but down in terms of rates. And that's because in the past few decades, our growth rates have started to go down. And the demographers predict that by 2100, the population growth will stop. Stop. Or it will slow down. It will take us years and years to have another billion. Why? Because fertility and deaths will balance, growth will be very slow. The population will get older, there'll be fewer young people, and a lot more older people. And demographers predict that the older people will be more educated and healthier. So maybe in time, by 2100, you don't need to have our law of retirement. No more retirement. There's no need, because the older people are more educated, more healthy, and they don't need a lot of disability pensions. So, but before we can do that, we are stuck here in the present. And that's why we want to find ways to lower population growth in the present so that we'll be able to reach those targets, those optimistic scenarios of the future. And what is one way in which we can lower population growth? Human capital. Education, and that's our focus today. So today, what we'll talk about is education as it relates to lowering of the population growth. And I'd like to tell you in this lecture why education matters a great deal in terms of our attempts to reduce population size. Okay? Are you still with me? Are you following me? Okay? Wake up, wake up, wake up. All right. Now, let's see. Education can be seen as either a flow or a stock. When you talk about flow, you mean the coming in and going out of schooling. So we look at enrollment rates for that. Education can also be seen as a stock. So we look at the quality, educational achievement, performance in tests, and see how our population is doing well. And again, I'm going to show you a lot of charts again. And when you look at the charts, you will probably feel two things, hope and concern. You will feel hope because we have done a lot to improve our educational situation. But you will also feel concerned because there are some areas of the world that are badly in need of more education. Let's talk about the flow of education. And let us take as an indicator the enrollment patterns of people in the world in primary schooling. And here's a chart. Now, if you look at all the chart, the dark green countries that you see are those with a very higher, almost 100%, close to 100% of your enrollment rate. And you can see the map is all green, which means we as a world have done a great job in ensuring a lot of primary education in the world, right? Congratulations! Hallelujah! But look at the colors of the other countries of light. Now, if you look at the countries closer, you'd have there Sudan, only 54.75%. Let's look at another country. You have here, Equatorial Guinea, which has 57.89. All right, I think Afghanistan is somewhere there also. And here's Eritrea, very low, 41.7. Very, very sad state of affairs. Let us look now at the high school pattern, which is the next chart. And again, you will find the light green areas are the ones with a lot of high school. The Philippines has 88%, so we're a little better off there. But look at, again, the light green and the dark green are the good. But look at the light ones again. Congo, there was about 40% in going to high school. What other countries are there? There, Sudan again, only 42.7% go to high school. So you can see there's a great deal of inequality and difference. Now, let us now compare what we have seen with college enrollment ratio as of 2014 and look at the differences across regions of the world. Here's the chart, and it shows us that you have North America there with the highest proportion, highest percentage of its population being in tertiary education, about 84.02%, followed by Eastern Europe and Central Asia, which includes Russia, which is about 62.7%. Now, you go down there, the world is only about 34% there, and South Asia is lower, That's about India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and then lower again is Sub-Saharan Africa, the same countries which we saw the last time. Now, the Philippines is about 20% in the college, and that's about the rate of South Asia and a little below the average for East Asia from which we belong there. But the patterns are the same. We're increasing the number of college students in the world, but inequalities still remain, and it's more disadvantaged in parts of Asia and certainly again in Africa. And these are the regions which will be the most populous in the next 80 years. We must do something about them to save the world and lead us to global prosperity. And now let us look now at the stock of human population, which is the quality of our population. Let us look now at the number of years of schooling. What is the average numbers of years of schooling in the world? Let us look at the chart again. And let us look at, if you can see all the dark ones in the chart, then you're talking about all the people who have 12 to 15 years average schooling. 12 to 15 years, halos college na yon, pero average yon sa bansa nila. All right? And you find that in like Australia and Western Europe and North America and things like that. All right. But look at, again, the other countries with a very low college. Angola, 5.1 years on the average of schooling, 5.4 years. In there, Sudan, 3.7 years. Very, very low, as very usual. Again, what I'm saying, hope for some, generally better, but in some countries, particularly Africa and some parts of Asia, there's a very, very great need again for a lot of population efforts in population educational expansion. All right, because again, they are very much dislocated from mainstream education. Now, another thing that we should consider is gender equality. One of the things that we have observed in many countries of the world is that women don't go to school as often as males. But we have some data on that. And what we have seen so far is that over the years, we have seen great improvements in equalizing the ratio of men and women entering schooling. If you look at the chart, you will see now, it's like a lot of arms here, arms, raising to the top, raising to the top there, to the top right there, to the 100%. 100% means equal yung males and females sa pagpasok sa average schooling nila, all right? And you will find that again in Europe, advanced economies, Caribbean, Latin America, Asia a little bit down below, and Philippines down below. So we still have a long way to go to reach the 100% equal. So right now it's still unequal. More males study than females, but perhaps later on we hope we will reach that equality. All right. So that is about gender ratio. Now let us look at the stock of human population and the performance of countries in international achievement tests. These reading, science, and math combined into a one score. And you will see in this chart that we'll show, on one hand, on the bottom axis, you will find the GDP from lowest to highest. On the vertical axis, you will find the performance test from low to high. And if one is high in the scoring and one high GDP, the concentration of the countries will be in the top right. So if you zero in on the top right of the chart, you will see the countries that have very high GDP and high test scores. And that's Singapore there, United States, Luxembourg, Japan, and things of the sort. And if you look lower there, the bottom, mababa na yung GDP, mababa pa yung scores sa exam, ayan mga Congo again, Africa, Cote d'Ivoire, and things like that. And there's part of India there a little bit close by. And again, you see some parts of Asia and some parts of Africa are again, worse off compared to many other countries. So we are getting better, but inequalities are still present, inequalities that we have to deal with. Another learning outcome is to cross-tabulate performance in the minimum proficiency test, and the advanced proficiency test. Again, kung mataas sa minimum, mataas sa proficiency advanced, they will again cluster in the top right. And here, you can see clustering again here, are the countries again, like China, like Taiwan, like Japan, really high. And again, low, if you look at the low ones, you will find again, it's the African countries, and again, some of the Asian countries getting involved again. Again, the patterns are very much the same. All right, inequalities remain present, and it's concentrated in countries or regions that are going to dominate the world in 2100, Asia and Africa. We will be dominant, but our stock of human capital needs more training to prepare ourselves for 2100, and we have to prepare now. And that is my message. Let us go on. Now, how do you change? How do you increase education? Well, how do you increase education? One, there were scientists in Vienna, all right, and what they did was that they got three factors, which is rapid development. They got also the idea of population being balanced with low birth rates and low death rates, and they also got sustainable development, all right? And they group all of these things into something called shared economic pathways. And they identified three scenarios, all right? Scenario one is the optimistic scenario, which is that there's rapid development, the school system expanded, you have low birth rates, and that's your optimistic scenario. Then you have two, which is the medium, some development, which is probably the likely thing to occur. And you have the scenario three, which is the most pessimistic. No development, no nothing, no progress, and hardly any fertility change, all right? Now, what the Viennese demographers did was they combined this into three scenarios and they correlated it with the educational attainment of people. And they did it elegantly in a triptych of charts. All right, here's the charts again. The pessimistic scenario is there on top, and then on the left and right is your other scenarios. The one on your left is the optimistic scenario. The four things you want to look at there. One, look at the height of the graph. Look at the one where it is the pasataas, pinakamataas na graph, which is the pessimistic scenario. Look at the height of that graph. It is taller, right? Look at the most optimistic scenario down there. It is much smaller. It is squat, or like Socrates, squat, a squat person, all right? Now, squat is cool. Squat is cool. And you can see, because of the optimistic, the population is lower, therefore squat yung population. Second, look at the pessimistic scenario. Look at the very thin band. But look at the optimistic, the band is fatter, it's more plump, all right? And mediums are SSP2. So in other words, with more development, there'll be more college educated people in the population, all right? So being plump, like being squat, is cool. Now, if you look at the red one, the third one, look at the red band. Look at this is the one with primary schooling. Look at the one in the optimistic scenario, you will see there's a red band there. Look at how that band in the optimistic scenario disappears. It goes out of sight. So three things are important. One, you're plump, you're squat, and you're out of sight. And that's the very, very things we're looking for when we are talking about education. So the Viennese demographers are able to show that with development, with population control, and with an expanded school system, you're going to bring that education level right up. All right? So, how do we do it? There are four reasons why education is very important. I'll get to you very briefly. One, education yields higher individual incomes and is also a necessary precondition for economic growth. All right? If you want higher GDPs and if you want better incomes for everybody, increase the level of education. All right? Second, education encourages pro-social behavior. You want more volunteerism, you want more interpersonal trust, you want more political participation in the country, then education is one good way to achieve these things. In fact, they found out in one study that those who were highly educated in a country with more education in 1970, usually in 1990, used to live, are living in a democratic political regime. So even that, even political behavior is affected by education. Number three, education spurs innovation, which means that we find that the more technologies there are in a country, it is always related to higher education population. You want the number of patents being registered, then greater number of patents are found in countries where there's also higher education. You can't have innovation without a lot of education. And fourth, perhaps more important, education, especially among women, contributes significantly to lowering down the population. The women are the secret weapon of population reduction. Why? Because women who get to school, particularly higher education, marry late. And when they marry late, they have fewer children. And if you have more women like that, fertility levels go down, 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 down. All right? And what's more, the more women are educated, there's also lower child mortality. Infants from 0 to 5 years old die less, so children survive. And you know, in many countries, children do not survive, so they have many children to make bawi. But if more children live with education of the women, then there will be fewer children. So the secret of education, particularly for women, is to lower population growth control. So what's the whole message here? Now, students, you go to school to earn a job and to get high income. Well, that will help. But remember, when you go to school, education is far more, has far more significant implications than simply your own personal job. It affects the country's state stock of human capital. It affects the development of the country. It affects the proportion of older people. It affects health of the nation as well. So what does it mean for you? To get to the path of global prosperity, we need education. Therefore, we must all do in our personal lives our very best to assist in expanding the pool of educated people in this country. I don't mean we'll all become teachers. That's not the case. I don't mean we'll all become principals and deans. That's not always the case. But we must expand the school system so it can be more inclusive. We must support efforts of sustainable development. We must try and attempt to lower population growth. And with all these three things, in our own way, we can increase the stock of human capital in this country and in the world and move in the direction of the optimistic scenario that the Viennese demographers talk about. That's the challenge. That's the challenge. So, as you can see, education matters. And it is our task to help expand the educational system and accommodate more people in the world. And when we do that, it might be good to remember a quotation from William Butler Yeats. And he says, education is not the filling of the pail, but the lighting of the fire. Repeat after me. Education is not the filling of the pail, but the lighting of the fire. So, you got that? Thank you very much. Now light your fire just when I signed off to start lighting your fire. And thank you very much for listening in. In the meantime, have fun doing it. Let's dance! Yeah! Yeah! Ah, ah.